Well, good morning, everybody. If you are interested at all in the slam trip, please make sure that you talk to Ruby. If not today in the foyer after the worship service is over, but maybe sometime throughout the week, you know, maybe even give her a little email about it. We would love to see a great big contingent from Kent Covenant Church go. All right? Now, if I haven't met you yet, like if this is one of your first times here, my name is Dan Schuttler, and I'm not the regular pastor, preacher up here. I am the pastor of worship and arts. But the staff was gone this week to the pastor's midwinter conference, and so they were all gone. So I get to preach this week since I stayed back. Now, just a second before we get started, I kind of want to give a shout out to a couple of people who kind of help enable our worship experience. A lot of times you just come in, the band is gone and everything, and worship kind of happens. You know, but we there's a lot of people that help make your experience and your encounter with God hopefully one that is an optimal experience for you each and every week. And they're a lot of these folks are in the background. They're unsung heroes, at least to me, if not to you. And I'm talking about our usher crew, and I'm talking about the people who are in the booth, and even our band people who are on the stage here. They make it happen each and every week, and a lot of times it's really fast to make this particular service happen because there's a very short window of time for the switchover. And I would love for us to give our booth people, our ushers, and our musicians a big round of thank you. Well, today in the Daniel Plan, we are talking about
food.
Yes, of course, naturally, it comes to me, the pastor of food, okay? I have been this for a very long time, although I was not the first pastor of food at Kent Covenant. That was Pastor David Job, and I was one of his disciples, and he has taught me well. And you know, today is a special day in American culture, isn't it? It's the
Super Bowl.
Yeah, see, the Seahawks aren't in it, so you're just going to the Super Bowl. It's not like Super Bowl! And I don't see a lot of jerseys today. There's not a lot of Atlanta Falcons jerseys out there, Patriots jerseys. But I know that a lot of us are going to probably watch this afternoon because after all, the commercials are what we watch for, right? The commercials are what we watch for. And I know a lot of you might go off the Daniel Plan bandwagon this afternoon with all those snacks and food when you're at parties, right? Am I right? Well, I want you to know that I'm trying to be faithful, okay? I made myself my patented football snack, and here it is. I brought a picture of it. Anybody guess what that is? Beet hummus. Yes, that is roasted beet hummus. Now I know, how many people love beets? Three people. No, beets aren't a favorite of some people, but if you make it into a hummus, it is absolutely wonderful. And if you want the recipe, you're gonna have to Google it, okay? Because I lost it somewhere. It's up here. But it's a wonderful, it's got carrot chips around it. My wife made it. It's gonna be great, and I'm not fall off the Daniel Penn bandwagon today. Now, last week, Pastor Keith, in his message, said, do we eat to live or do we live to eat? Do we eat to live or do we live to eat? I know that too often I live to eat because I love food. It hasn't always been that way. You know, my mother, God bless her, she's a great mom, but back in the 60s, 50s, you know, I was fed orange juice when I was like 3 weeks old, you know, and different kinds of things, and yet she provided lots of different meals each and every meal. She wore out that Betty Crocker cookbook, giving me all sorts of different things besides steak and mashed potatoes. I had, you know, liver and fried chicken and a lot of different kind of things, and weird kind of creamed vegetable-y dishes and jello with grated carrots. And I'll see, I see some people nodding. Yeah, wonderful things that just stoked my appetite as an 8-year-old. Yeah, I wasn't really a vegetable eater until in high school, all of a sudden my taste buds came in because I started eating different places and I went away to college and I had a different experience there. And then I met my wife and I moved to Colorado. And her family introduced me to bagels, which I thought were just a tasteless donut for a long time. I said, this is the worst tasted donut I've ever eaten, you know, until I discovered that you put, you know, cream cheese, you know, lox on, all sorts of great things. And bagels are one of my favorite foods. And they also introduced me to salmon. I'd never had salmon. And great Mexican food, because in Nebraska, Mexican food is Taco Bell. Okay, and that was back when they had five things on the menu, not 500 things. And so, and then I got married, went to the East Coast, and I discovered cheesecakes and New York style pizza and crab cakes and delicious fish that I'd never tasted before. And then we moved out here to the Northwest, where I discovered all the fresh berries that were out here, different kinds of fish, teriyaki, gourmet donuts, you know, all that wonderful thing from the Northwest. And then Kent becomes this immigrant community. So I get to taste all these different foods that the people who come to church, especially the people who learn English on Tuesdays and Thursdays, they have potlucks every once in a while. And I get to go to those. So I'm tasting food from all over the world, and I just absolutely love it. And being in a covenant church doesn't hurt, because the covenant church has a long, long history of fellowship and eating together. In fact, the other day I was just kind of wandering the halls, minding my own business, you know. And all of a sudden, I looked inside room A and B in the Carlson Center. Ladies are having their Bible study on Thursday morning. What do I see? I see, look at that, two tables actually, full of food. And that's actually after we started the Daniel plan. I know you ladies. But really, I did go in there after a while. I was invited in. And pastor food. And there were some healthy things in there. There were some really healthy things in there. So ladies, congratulations, you're doing a great job. And you know, around this church, you know, there is food here nearly year round, by the pound. So I found, and it astounds, and that's why I'm round. Okay? So there you go. So today we talk about food, one of my favorite subjects, and unfortunately one of the pillars of the Daniel plan. In fact, let's see all those pillars together. If you're handed a bulletin, take your bulletin. They're sitting right there on the front, okay? Right on the front. And if you don't have it, repeat after me. Ready? Faith. Food. Fitness. Focus. Friends. All right, amen, let's pray. No. Now, the Daniel plan is all about abundance, not deprivation. Sometimes you see Daniel plan, oh, we're not gonna eat anything, we're gonna go on this starvation diet. No. It's about abundance, not deprivation. We are invited to eat delicious whole foods that will bring vitality and energy to your body and mind. And each healthy choice that you make fuels your progress and motivates you to stay the course. Stay the course. I don't know about you, but that's difficult for me throughout the years. Now, when I was almost getting married, the year before I got married, my brother-in-law-to-be gave me a book to read called Sugar Blues. I don't know if you remember that. It was back in the beginning, but it was a long time ago. And this book inspired me to give up sugar. To give up sugar. And I did it for about a year until our living circumstances. We got married and dealing with some folks, and their diet wasn't going to happen, so I went back on sugar. I've been there ever since, as you can probably tell. But I felt great that year. I felt wonderful that year. And then throughout my life, I've tried different things, different exercise regimes, and I kind of always, despite my good intentions, I fall a little short. It kind of reminds me of one of my favorite food songs from the 1970s. I don't know if you remember this, by Jimmy Buffett. Tried to amend my carnivorous habits, made it nearly 70 days. Losing weight without speed, eating sunflower seeds, drinking lots of carrot juice and soaking up rays. But at night, I'd have these wonderful dreams, some kind of sensuous treat, not zucchini fettuccine or bulgur wheat, but a big warm bun and a huge hunk of meat. Yes, it's cheeseburger in paradise, heaven on earth with an onion slice. I'm not too particular, I'm not too precise. I'm liking a cheeseburger in paradise. Anybody with me? Yeah. Yeah. Cheeseburger in paradise. And then, you know, and that just would fall off the wagon, you know, for those wonderful cheeseburgers. But let me say again that the Daniel plan is not a diet plan. So if it's not a diet plan, why is then food listed as one of the pillars? Because food, if eaten the right way, with the right motivation and understanding, not only has the power to nourish, to refresh, to heal, to restore, but it also has the ability to combine with the other pillars for a picture of whole health in us, body, mind, and spirit. And our focus on food today allows us to give God thanks for his provision, to give thanks for the health that we receive from him, to give thanks for the creation that he has made and the unique design of our bodies and how they work. And food also has the ability to help us focus on our own relationship with God. Now, let's go to our text for today, Daniel chapter 1, verses 8 through 16. Now, Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to them by the king. And he asked the chief of staff for permission to not eat these unacceptable foods. Now, God had given the chief of staff both respect and affection for Daniel. And he responded, "I'm afraid, my lord, the king, who has ordered you to eat this food and wine, if you become pale and thin compared to the other youths of your age, I'm afraid that the king's going to have me beheaded." And Daniel spoke with this attendant, who had been appointed by the chief of staff, to look after not only Daniel, but also Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And he said to the attendant, please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water. And at the end of the 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food. Then make your decision in light of what you see. And the attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion, and he tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the young men who had been eating the food assigned by the king. So after that, the attendant fed them only vegetables instead of food and wine provided by the others. And we see in this passage a great example of Daniel, not only standing by his religious principles, but also believing that by focusing on his faith and giving his body what was needed for nourishment instead of what the Babylonians were eating, that God's plan is going to win out, that God's plan was going to be the superior plan. Now, you know, in days like these, we all face pressure to eat unhealthy, don't we? We're bombarded by food, things. You know, I love Cheez-Its. You know, this is terrible. Oh, yes, food, yes, you know. Those things, like, crack to me. I just, it's hard to stop when I'm eating Cheez-Its. And the food industry gives us such immense pressure to eat for the best interest of the food industry, don't they? But you know what? We don't face any kind of pressure like the way Daniel felt pressure. Because you see, King Nebuchadnezzar had really kind of taken a shine to Daniel, kind of looked at him as a favorite son and also his friends. And he didn't want those friends to turn up sick. He gave them whatever they wanted to eat, you know, drink, become Babylonians. You know, he wanted them to really kind of be leaders. And if they turned up sick, then, you know, that was the end of them. Now, Daniel's objection to the food that he was being offered, it was too rich for them to eat. It was because that it was not kosher. For Jews, food is not merely a matter of health. It's also a question of obedience to God. It's an issue of faith, isn't it? Those eating rules. There are many restrictions in the Old Testament that God gave the Hebrews. Now, can food for us be an issue of faith? Well, the New Testament says that it's really not necessary for Christians to eat kosher in order to be obedient to God. There's not a lot of list of long, you know, rules for us to follow under the New Covenant. Food is an issue of faith for us because God made us and loves us, and he wants the best for us. And so we owe it for ourselves to keep ourselves up and to not let ourselves go and not trash ourselves. You know, when we drive up to the gas pump, we want to make sure we put gas in that's going to work in our cars, right? We want to make sure that the kind of energy we have coming into our house, the gas or oil, whatever it is going to be the proper thing to keep us warm. So wouldn't we also do the same with our own bodies? Give it good food and good fuel for that. Now, that's not to say we should ever eat rich foods or sweet foods. There's a time and a place. But it's not every day. It's not all the time. You know, our ancestors saved those things for special feasts throughout the year, okay? In fact, what's the point of keeping the feast of Easter without keeping the fast of Lent? So you see, it's a matter of faith. And the point that Daniel Payne makes about food is that is that food is tasty and it is beautiful and it's wonderful as God has made it. It doesn't need to be highly processed in a factory. And so I want to meet, this leads me up to, I'm going to ask Pastor Keith to come up and interview a couple of folks from our congregation to give us a little more information in that area. So please, let's welcome up Pastor Keith.
Thank you, Pastor Dan. Pastor Dan drew the short straw and had to stay here this week while the rest of the pastoral staff went off to Louisville, Kentucky. So, and by the way, he's the one who preached this Sunday because, you know, we were all gone. Whenever I ask anybody else to preach for me, they always get sick at least one day in the week before they're supposed to preach. And that did happen with Pastor Dan. He spent a day sick. We were texting back and forth. But I'm glad he's healthy today. And did you notice Pastor Dan, even though he's preaching today, he was also playing the piano? He originally had it set up for somebody else to play the piano. But, of course, that person got sick, so he jumped in there. So, you know, Pastor Dan wears a lot of hats. Sometimes I don't think we do enough to thank him for everything he does around here. So can we take a minute? Just to thank him. All right. Well, in keeping with the Daniel Plan book, you have a couple of chapters that you read on healthy eating and food. And I thought it would be kind of fun, because I know we have people in our congregation who know a lot more about this than I do, to have them come and share some of their thoughts and perspectives. So I would like to invite Mika Greideck and Dana Sindelar to please come forward and join me for this next segment. Have your own cheering section over here. They didn't cheer that loud for me. So to get started, just so people know who you are, would you just each share kind of your, what you do, you know, for your day job and how you come to your perspectives about healthy eating and food? We'll start with you, Mika.
Thank you, Pastor Keith, for this opportunity. Welcome, everyone. I'm Mika Greideck, and I'm an anthropologist and nutritionist. And for the last 13 years, I have my own practice, and I also work for Catholic Community Services. And what I mainly do is I support and I walk people through the healing process, and I do evaluation and assist them in making healthy food changes and lifestyle changes.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dana Sindelar. I'm a registered dietitian, a clinical dietitian, and certified diabetes educator here in the area at MultiCare Health Systems. And I've been here working in this area since 1999, and before that I worked in California in the hospital setting. So I did more acute care and med surgical units. So I have both clinical and outpatient background.
Great, thank you. So I know you've studied all of this a lot and worked with a lot of people on issues of eating and health and healing. And I did send these guys the questions ahead of time, okay? And made me a little bit nervous when they both showed up with like four pages of notes, you know? Like maybe they're gonna preach today, but we'll try to manage this, all right? So, and you'll wanna hear the first part of this question. In about 2 minutes or less, That's 2 minutes each. What is the best eating or food advice you would give people based on what you see and what you know from your professional experience? So this is kind of the elevator speech. You know, we talk about the elevator speech, which 2 minutes is a long one. But what, you know, if you just had to boil it all down to a nutshell and you only had 2 minutes to talk to somebody, what would you say?
Thank you, Pastor Keith, but I'm going to pass it to Dana because it's like it's impossible for me to cover all this in 2 minutes, but I'm gonna learn from her and give her the voice first.
All right, so typically when people come into my office and I'm working with them and trying to help them figure out what change they wanna make, we've gotta start with an assessment. We gotta take stock in what's going on. And that pun is intended, by the way. We gotta look at all the food that is in the pot and say, what's going on here? So typically I have them write down with me a worksheet, and we look at all the elements that affect nutrition. And without that, we can't really move forward. I've actually tried to do it without it, just go straight to talking nutrition, and we don't get as far. So basically, I find out what time they eat, What time do they wake up? What time do they go to bed? Do they eat out a lot? You know, are they conscious about what they're eating? Or are they somewhat unconscious? The day happens to them rather than they happen to the day. And usually we'll then go directly to a diet recall of what time are they eating, how much are they eating, and what are they eating. And so when you just put that down on paper and sit with somebody, their goals can change. They can look at that paper and they can say, okay, I've got work to do and these are the areas I'd like to do it. And usually that's where I start. And from that, I typically have a thing in my head, it's called TAB, or keeping tabs on your diet, and I break down those areas, and it's timing, control of amount, and dietary balance. And it's huge inside of every group. It means something different to every person. And bottom line is that a lot of those areas are out of control. One time I might work for hours with just timing, several visits. How do you work your day? How do you make your plans based on your day? The next time I might say, hey, let's look at calories. How many calories are you eating when you go out to eat? And so on and so forth. Is it too much? Is it too little? And then balance, the quality of the foods is really important. And that all sounds kind of blah, 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 but when you're an individual and you sit down and you look at it, it becomes very real. And then you have little things to work on step by step.
That's very right, Dana is so right. You know, I do kind of the same thing. But in addition to that, you know, trying to evaluate and help people through understanding what relationship we have with food. Is it based on being an emotional eater, or is there other factors contributing to the way we're eating? And kind of, you know, becoming a little bit organized, it's so important. So, you know, I'm huge on plant-based diet and superfoods, and so, you know, to achieve that goal, to be able to put it in our body, we have to have access to it first. So stocking up our fridges and our pantries, and, you know, loads of veggies, number one, you know, fresh fruits, everything that's whole, that's unprocessed, and that's real, then that should be within our reach. Because if it's not, then no matter if we're trying to follow Daniel's plan or Pastor Kim's plan or thinking our own plan, we're going to fail, right? So that's what, you know, as far as, you know, if I can give any advice and suggestion, you know, just this should be the start. And another one is to team up with somebody, you know, so even going grocery shopping, you know, having someone to inspire and to kind of, you know, partner with, either it is your son or daughter or your husband or a friend, someone who can kind of, you know, who can keep each other accountable. And it's so important to, you know, to have developed healthy eating habits to be able to address all those things first.
Thank you very much. I haven't rolled out the Pastor Keith plan yet, but it's coming. It's definitely coming. Yeah, you made me think of something that's in the materials, and I think people will hear this, but when you talked about processed foods, and one of the sayings in the book is shorten the distance from the field to the fork as a healthy eating tip. I thought that was kind of cool. I retained that one. All right, let's go on to the next question. What did you like most about the emphasis of the chapters on food in the Daniel Plan book, or the, you know, the Daniel Plan in general? So if each of you would comment on things that were in those two chapters.
All right, so I don't know if you all read it, but it's 75 pages of information. And so to pick a few areas was, wow, where do I go with this? But I can say that I could probably teach directly out of the book. There's a lot of really good information. The biggie that stood out to me was inflammation and the causes of inflammation. The foods that we eat are so highly inflammatory. Two categories that really pop out there are the sugars in our diets. You know, they hide everywhere. They're lurking in salad dressings, you know, the drinks that we have at Starbucks. Not that I'm trying to hurt Starbucks or anything, but you know, any latte stand. And so I was finding a little tidbit interesting. It was talking about how the hunter-gatherers used to have 22 teaspoons of sugar a year. And we are consuming 30 teaspoons a day. And that's 152 pounds of sugar a year. So that's quite a bit, and our bodies just don't know how to process that. And that leads to inflammation. It starts in the gut. You know, the gut bacteria don't like it, they overeat it. and then we create bad bacteria there, which causes holes in the gut almost, like if you will, and then things can cross into our bloodstream that don't belong there, and that increases inflammation throughout the body, which increases the risk of diabetes, which is the area I work in, cancer, heart disease, dementia was big too. And so why would we want to do that to ourselves, right? I mean, it's definitely worth working on. And so, and then the second part of that inflammatory foods that I thought was interesting was the white approach. And doctors often will send patients to me and they'll tell them, go talk to the dietitian about not eating any more white food. And so it's like, oh, okay, here we go again. They're gonna come in and they're gonna have the white food agenda. So basically, if you break it down, it's just processed food. It's refined, it's in a package, it has 10,000 ingredients and you can barely understand what they are. So the goal is to move towards whole, pure foods. And it takes a lot of work. You really have to focus and be ready for it. So going back to my original thing, you want to take an assessment of where you're at. Are you ready to attack some really difficult situation here, right? And really learn about what you're eating. And there's, you can do it. You just gotta go into the pages here and little by little, just one thing at a time, and it will make a big difference.
Wow, Dana covered it all pretty much.
What was the most important? But
that's so funny. You know, and it is, in my opinion, the same thing. It's the most important thing. It's looking at the anti-inflammatory diet, you know, supporting the reducing the chronic inflammation, which is the root cause of most of the diseases today. But another thing that really, was wonderful for me to see that is in Daniel's plan is probiotic rich foods. You know, I'm coming from Eastern Europe, from Poland, you know, our diet was full of probiotic foods. We did fermented foods pretty much every day. We ate sauerkraut and kimchi and, you know, pickles, and, you know, pickled cucumbers and pickled carrots and radishes. And nobody had digestive issues. And right now, a lot of people do have that. So I do encourage you, you know, looking into that piece. It's really, really easy to make fermented foods. You know, you can pretty much pickle anything. And there's so many. What's wonderful right now is, and there's a lot of references in Daniel's book too, and recipes, and you know, all this thing that we can access now through social media. It's wonderful. You know, on YouTube, you can just do a search. You know, how to make pickled cucumbers or sauerkraut, and or you know, another one now that is so common is making kombuchas. I think that's so wonderful because you know, our gut has more than 500 species of different bacteria, and our ratio, you know, between the DNA, it's 10 to 1, you know, so bacteria versus DNA cells. And, you know, if those ratios start going down, we start struggling. And as Dana was saying, you know, leads to something called leaky gut syndromes, you know, we have tremendous imbalances, and, you know, our system, digestive system cannot process, let's say, protein, for example, that's a huge one. And that's starting to have that leaky gut syndrome, and that leads to all kinds of chronic illnesses and autoimmune disorders. So I love that fact that it's a huge piece on that, and it's so easy for people to access and understand it. And another thing that's, you know, I'm just going to summarize all this is what I love about Daniel's plan is that emphasizes that it's never too late to start doing the right thing and eating right. You know, either we children or teenagers or adults, or even, you know, in our elderly age, we can start today and understanding that our body is a miracle that God created, you know, with the ability to self-heal. And as long as we start today doing the right thing, the body will continue to heal. And unless we stop, then it stops the healing process. But if we just stay committed to it, that healing process and journey will continue. So I do encourage you to please start today. And we are here for you. And, you know, me and Dana, we are available after the service. And from now on, we're thinking with Pastor Keith to collaborating some kind of thing to maybe have a support.
Great. Thank you very much. Now, not done yet. This is kind of show and tell Sunday for me. So just, by the way, I read a book that had a big impact on me, and it was by one of the authors of this book. It was by Dr. Mark Hyman, who's with the Cleveland Clinic. It was called Eat Fat, Get Thin. And it was talking about the fact that low-fat diets took all of the healthy fats out of our diet, and that we need healthy fats and oils. Our bodies need healthy fats and oils.
Amen.
And we, yes, see, somebody else knows what I'm talking about. And what happened when you took all the fat out is food lost its flavor. So what did the food industry do to make up for the loss of flavor? They dumped sugar in it, all right? So now we get way too much sugar, by the way. A can of Coke, 15 teaspoons of sugar. Now, how many people would put 15 teaspoons of sugar in their coffee in the morning? Okay, but that's what you get. And then you say, oh, well, I drink Diet Pop. Well, then you get something that's actually worse than sugar, isn't that right? Because aspartame and the others are much harder on our bodies. So if you have to have sweet, better to have just a little bit of sugar or honey or something like that. Now, you don't want to hear that from me, but I thought that'd be kind of fun. I started reading labels, okay? And that's one of the things you have to do, learn how to read labels. So I want you guys to tell me if this is actually food. This is salad dressing. See, here sometimes we say, well, I'm gonna eat healthy. I'm gonna have a salad, right? And being on the West Coast, we throw kale in there and we think, man, that really makes it healthy, right, Pastor Ruby? Okay, then we dump some of this on there. All right, give me the answer. Non-hydrogenated soybean oil. Is that food? No, not good, huh? High fructose corn syrup. Is that good? No, not very good. Okay, how about this? Distilled vinegar, salt, garlic, and onion. That's okay. Good, we got a little bit of food in here. Hey, how about this one? I can't even pronounce it. Xanthan gum, and in parentheses, a natural food fiber. What's xanthan gum? Okay, if you can't pronounce it, all right. How about this one? Benzoate and potassium sorbate as preservatives. You guys are not happy about that. How about this? Calcium disodium EDTA to protect the quality. They're chemicals, that's what they are. How about this one? Caramel color. Is that bad? Okay. All right, you get the point. So, you know, you gotta be careful about what you eat, and you might start out healthy with a salad, and then you dump some of this Italian dressing. Pastor Dan, since you love food so much, I'm gonna give that to you. You can have it, take it home. And then one more thing. Now, some people accuse me, when I read that other book, of believing in fringe science. Is this fringe science in the Daniel plan?
40 references in the back of the book on chapter 4. Wait, what's chapter 4? The food chapter? Yeah.
Okay. Here's what I want to read. This is the front page of the Seattle Times, folks. I'm not usually one who's given to conspiracy theories, okay? But I think when it makes the front page of the Seattle Times, you might want to pay attention to it. Sugar industry paid off scientists in the 1960s, okay? And it says it may have influenced future dietary advice. In other words, the sugar industry, concerned about the fact that Americans were becoming obese and there was more diabetes, blamed it on fat. And the real culprit is sugar and too much sweetness. Now, nobody's saying you can't have any sugar, but we're just saying it's something you have to be careful about, right? Okay, I got more show and tell stuff, but I'm gonna quit right there. So let's show our appreciation to Mika and Dan.
See a show of hands for everybody who believes that Pastor Keith has ever tasted kale. Come on, if you ever think he's tasted kale, put your hands up, all right? And Pastor Keith, have you ever tasted kale? Okay, there we go. But as we heard Mika say, it's never too late. Okay, so Pastor Keith, that's good news for you. To kind of make up this transition from the message into communion, I want to share just a few other Bible verses. There's lots of Bible verses about food, but these couple I just want to bring to our attention. 1 Corinthians 10, 31 says, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. In all things, we have the opportunity to show God to others. Perhaps it's in the way we offer food to a sick friend, or maybe offer a drink to a thirsty child. Perhaps it's in the way we invite the hungry to our table. Whatever. And however we eat and drink, we can invite others to God's table by our example. In Matthew 6:25, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body and what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? You see, Jesus knew we were going to have these concerns. We were going to be worried about these kind of things, and that they would get in the way of what life is truly all about. Matthew 6:25 is his reminder to focus upon him and his ways and how they cover our problems. And in John 6:35, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. You know, we never have to know the ache of hunger that comes from a life of spiritual starvation. Because Jesus wants us to know that we have everything that we need as long as we have him. Though we may physically grow hungry, it will never outweigh his gift of eternal life and fulfillment in him. And to top it all off, Jesus sanctified eating and drinking when he took the bread and the wine and said, take and eat. Drink in remembrance of me. So is food an issue of faith? It was for Daniel, and it still is for us who sit together at the table and eat and drink with Jesus. To prepare us for communion, I want us to sing a hymn as a familiar tune. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4 of this hymn, and I'd like you to stand up as we sing this together, and let's focus on these words for communion.